with standards. How is this different? As I said, it seems like it should be purely about technical issues and technical concerns. Why do we have values arguments here at all in the standards debate? Well, for one, clearly the fairness issues, the justice issues, the accessibility issues all arise when the primary actor is government. And the government acts in two ways, right? Government either acts to select particular standards, or government acts to intervene and regulate the relationships between parties in the market in one way that might factor in to favor one, that would end up in some way favoring one party over another. And when government intervenes, the issues regarding fairness and legitimacy and values on parties are inevitable. And especially when you have a relatively complex group of actors, as you're beginning to have in much of the debate, this is going to happen. So we have a values debate with respect to standards. The question for us to think about is, do you resist this? Do you resist having a values debate and try to say, this is only a technical issue? This is about efficiency alone. And I think that's a mistake, because I think it doesn't help you solve or figure out what is the proper relationship between so-called openness and open standards and proprietary standards, because that argument happens along two levels of discourse. You need to be able to address both of them. And if you're going to resolve whatever tensions there are, you need to find a way to get a merger. So, I think as a basic, of course, there's ideology and values that come to the open source, open standard, open source argument. I think one of the things we need to realize, and I think Mario put this right, efficiency, the idea of efficiency, the idea of technical, comes with its own ideology. It's an ideology of markets, markets being best. And it's a valid approach. But it means that there has to be a recognition that technical is not necessarily independent or value neutral in terms of what ends you're trying to achieve, because of a key thing, right? Which is that standards don't exist independently. They are meant, they are there to achieve particular goals. And yes, there is the firm level at which these will operate, maybe a second level, but there's also an economy-wide level. There's an industrial economic policy level, which they offer. So, in thinking about this debate, is there anything new under the sun with respect to standards and the ITR and open debate? I would say yes or no, which is your typical lawyer answer, but I think what we have here, at least in this debate at the moment, is the clash of technicians first realizing that politics and values do affect the architecture of this. The design of standards, politics and values do affect the design and selection of standards. And that's something that has to be acknowledged. And then the question is, how do you manage that? How do you deal with it? And what are the right ones to pay attention to, and what are the wrong ones to pay attention to? And so think about reconciliation here. I think of this maybe as a sort of a two-step process, reconciling the two discourses, right? First, right, technicians' realization that they're not entirely devoid of values, ideology themselves. But also this idea, which I think everybody has brought up at a certain point, of purposive architecture. So that looking at the difference between programming, problem solving, which is what programmers and engineers do. They solve little problems. But they don't do architecture. They don't do management and design and interface with, except maybe in that narrow problem-solving sense. And it's at that level of design and management where you have to ask the argument, why are we doing this? What end are we trying to achieve? I think it's not useful to think about total consumer welfare. On the level of each and every standard, we ask the question, why are we doing this? Why do we need to stand in this particular area at this particular time? What end are we trying to achieve? And that then gives us a purposive way to think about it, and then that helps us to figure out the level of implication. The level of implication for consumer welfare specifically in that particular area. So in this sense, purposes of architecture would refer to a sense of what the public welfare goal is at a disaggregated level for each particular standard that you are thinking about developing. The greater the public consumer welfare interest at the at that specific level, the more care is needed to address values issues, such as justice, equity, fairness, accessibility. However, you also then have the opposite, right? That the converse is also true. That the less you have to, the less of sort of broader public interest, the more you can rely on the discourse on efficiency to get to pick and choose what particular standard, what particular process you want to use. And as I mentioned before, the dangers when these values and efficiency discourses are conflated. One of the methodologies that I think I can refer to is something that was done by two old professors of mine, Dan Farber and Greg McDonald from the University of Minnesota Law School, where they discussed the use of values or the use of a fairness standard as a tiebreaker, where when the economic efficiency issues are tied or ambiguous, that fairness becomes a tiebreaker for deciding how to distribute the additional consumer surplus or producer surplus generated by a standard setting process, and doing so in an ex ante way rather than a post ex post. Finally, I think I'd like to close with maybe another way of looking at standards that I think maybe helps us to think about why there's a valid discussion. Standards can also be viewed from the perspective of government as a utility. It's something that is providing services at a broad level or federal level to a set of consumers, etc. And the standards provide a service to the polity. And in that sense, when thinking about how utilities work, we can see that there is an element of both public process and private process, public ownership and private ownership. That is not necessary when you think about it as a utility, standards utility, you don't have to choose one or the other. Ownership can be disaggregated and measured between public and the private, and implementation and operation can be measured and distributed between public and the private. In that sense, looking at the open standard and propriety standard, so-called dichotomy, when you think about it in terms of providing utility, you really then identify in that process of service provision who has the best tools to do the best task at that time. Thinking about it as a set of tools that are available rather than ideological offices that you need to figure out how to converge on. Thanks.